Good morning, members. I call to order the meeting of the Subcommittee on Designation of Museums, Amendment Order 2024. Agenda item number one. Let's first invite the administration to join us. We're going to discuss the Designation of Museums, Amendment Order 2024. Let's welcome Undersecretary Mr. Raislin Lau and his team to join us. If members are ready, you can press the request to speak button. Good morning. With us today are Mr. Raislin Lau, Undersecretary for Culture, Sports and Tourism, Ms. Lam, Assistant Director, Heritage and Museums, Mr. Ng Chee Wo, Head of Chinese Culture, Mr. Terence Zhang, Museum Director, Museum of History. Let's invite the administration to walk us through the amendment order. There's a PowerPoint presentation. Undersecretary, please. Good morning, Chairman. The Designation of Museums Amendment Order 2024 was gazetted on the 17th of May and was tabled to the Legislative Council on the 22nd of May by way of negative vetting. It is expected to come into effect in September this year. I thank members for expressing valuable views on converting the Hong Kong MCD to Hong Kong Museum of the War Resistance and Coastal Defense. Lei Yue Mun has been an important traffic thoroughfare and a strategic point of war. Historically, there is record of different events in Lei Yue Mun. It has held a strategic point since ancient times. There are still forts in Qing and Ming dynasties, including Tong Chung forts, Tong Long Chau forts, and so on. It reflects coastal defense facilities during Ming and Qing dynasties. The Hong Kong Museum of the War Resistance of Coastal Defense lists our history of war of the resistance. We protected our country and our place in Hong Kong. The government attaches great importance to the War of Resistance history so that the public will better know the contributions of the people in Hong Kong back then. We have added many more exhibitions about the War of Resistance, including four galleries about the War of Resistance, about the fall of China, East River Column, and the contributions of martyrs. The museum will make better use of the galleries to hold exhibitions about the history of the War of Resistance. The first will take place on the 3rd of September. We will partner with Shenzhen Municipal Cultural Relics Bureau to hold this exhibition. We'll continue to honor the 115 martyrs of the Hong Kong Independent Battalion of the East River Column in order to highlight their importance. In order to give the public more knowledge about the East River Column, we will also put up exhibitions to introduce the martyrs of the East River Column. We'll continue to enhance the QR code arrangements online in order to allow the public to access better information. In September, the museum will roll out a series of public publicity work and public education in order to allow visitors and the public to acquire knowledge about the war of resistance. This way we can foster patriotism and national education. I give the floor to my colleague to give members more information. I'm going to give you more information about the coastal defense of Hong Kong. Hong Kong is a strategic point of defense as a gateway to southern China. Our defense was integrated with that of Shenzhen in Guangdong. The coastal map of Guangdong in a record of Guangdong in 1595 reflected the name of Lei Yuemun. It shows its importance. In the year 1819, the Chronicle of Sun On shows the geographical location of Lei Yuemun. Right now, the picture shows that Lei Yuemun is in the eastern part of Hong Kong. It occupies an important position to protect Hong Kong. The location of Hong Kong MCD reflects Lei Yuemun as a strategic point since ancient times. I'm going to give you more information about the galleries. The first gallery it's about the coastal defense in Hong Kong. It shows different relics. Different galleries have different themes. The Chinese government never recognizes the three unequal treaties. The sovereignty of Hong Kong still belongs to China. There is also a gallery about China's People's Liberation Army, Hong Kong Garrison. There are four galleries: Narrative of the War of Resistance, Joint Hands to Resist Japanese Invasion of Hong Kong, and Anti-Japanese Guerrillas Behind Enemy Lines Gallery. These have the theme of the War of Resistance against Japanese aggression. There are plaques to highlight the theme. We will also show a lot of historical pictures and relics. There are multimedia shows to show in an interesting manner the oral history of guerrilla members. In the Hong Kong Museum of the War, Resistance and Coastal Defense, we will hold thematic exhibitions. This September, we will hold the exhibition Fight as One, War of Resistance Activities of East River Column in Shenzhen and Hong Kong Areas. It allows the people of Hong Kong to know more about the history of the people in Hong Kong and Shenzhen in the war against resistance. We will also launch public education programs to give the public more understanding of the war of resistance. We will make use of the space of the museum to let the public know more about the coastal defense history. Apart from the mobile app, that is, there are QR codes on IM Guide. We will also show QR codes on the exhibit so that the public or visitors can access the relevant information directly through the QR codes. We will also show the excerpts from three films by Hong Kong directors about the War of Resistance. One, The Battle of Shanghai, two, Hong Kong 1941, and three, Our Time Will Come. This area can accommodate more visitors. We will also show the awards, and the name of the 115 members of the Hong Kong Independent Battalion of the East River Column. We are also going to collect more relics in the War of Resistance. This is a collection campaign. It is for research purposes. So the establishment of the Hong Kong Museum of the War Resistance and Coastal Defense highlights the theme of war resistance and coastal defense. We will also put in place public education programs in order to cultivate a stronger sense of national esteem and patriotism among the public. Thank you. 9 members have already pressed a button to request to speak. They are in order. Mr. Perry Yu, Mr. Chen Xiu-Hong, Professor Lau Chi-Pan, Mr. Vincent Chang, Ma Feng Kwok, Ms. Elizabeth Kwok, Mr. Benson Lok, Ms. Maggie Chen, Judy Chen, Starry Lee, and Mr. Lam Chen Sing. 4 minutes, question and answers included. Mr. Perry Yu, please. Thank you, Chairman. Well, I wanted to listen to Professor Lau first, but I pressed the button earlier. I'm going to express my views on the document. To convert the Hong Kong MCD to Hong Kong Museum of the War Resistance and Coastal Defense, I support this amendment order. I have no objections. But in the document, probably the administration would like to pay greater attention. That is to hold thematic exhibitions about the war of resistance and to show the relationship of the coastal defense history. Probably we should use the word country, our country. During the Ming and Qing dynasties, according to the Chronicle of Sun On, we can see that Lei Yunmun has been a strategic point in coastal defense. The exhibition space is quite limited. It occupies an area of 1,165 square feet. The entire museum has an area of 34,200 square meters. So can the administration explore expanding the area on the War of Resistance and incorporating more elements to the museum? Actually, not just Shao Kei Wan, but Lei Yunmun in Kowloon. There are many military sites on the mountain. They are from the period of British colonial rule. So can we combine all these elements and develop those areas into open-air museums so they can complement with each other? So we not only have Shao Kei Wan, but also Lei Yunmun in Kowloon. When the Hong Kong MCD was reopened in 2022, we can see progress or improvement in the museum. Actually, many visitors went to the Hong Kong MCD. This is my opinion. The industry, I mean the tourism industry, is also concerned about the tour guide service. For museums under the LCSD, they do not accept reservations from travel agencies. They think that travel agencies are profit-making organizations, but it's self-contradicting. Actually, travel agencies are intermediaries helping visitors to make bookings. So can you put in place a mechanism so that travel agents can also make good use of the services? Museums have an educational role. Without a docent, without a guided tour, the museum may not be perform its function as well. So allow the secretary have a minute. Thank you, Professor Lau. Thank you, Mr. Perry Yu. We'll take on board your views. We collect different views from time to time. We need to consider the issue of resources and priority. It is not the case that we do not want to provide guided tour services to travel agents, but because of resource limitations, we want to accord priority to students and non-profit-making organizations. When we have sufficient resources, we are more than willing to expand this service. Museum can also provide courses for docents or tour guides to give them more knowledge about walking visitors through the museum. So we'll work with the tourism sector. Thank you.
Yeah.
Next is Chen Xiuhong. Well, Hong Kong has always lacked a museum dedicated to the war of resistance. There are only isolated exhibitions in the community. So setting up this Hong Kong Museum of the War of Resistance and Coastal Defense, concentrating on the war of resistance history to raise national esteem and patriotism, is something that I totally support. Hong Kong, there are a number of anti-war relics, like in Sai Kung, the Catholic Church, and also some memorial statues. I think that this particular museum can have a systematic introduction on the history and also the relics related to the war of resistance. And there will be good reference materials for people interested in the history of the war of resistance. There have been some discussions on the name of the museum, that is War of Resistance and Coastal Defense. Hong Kong is an island, as mentioned by the Undersecretary. The location of the museum actually is related to the history of coastal defense. I've seen a number of museums in China along the coast. There are museums named coastal. Like in Shenzhen, there is a Daipan Museum of Coastal Defense, concentrating on the history of and culture of coastal defense. In Zhejiang Province, Zhoushan City, there's also a Museum of Coastal Defense. So in light of the fact that Hong Kong is an island sited on the coast, so coastal defense should be used in the name. So even though it got an area of more than 30,000 square meters, the indoor space for exhibition is limited. If you want to also focus on the theme of resistance, which I support, but because of the space constraint, the information display on the history of coastal defense may be also restrained. Therefore, in relation to your partner's point, well, I know you need to set priorities because of limited resources, but do you have to plan that within the 30,000 plus square meters site to create extra buildings or add to it additional facilities, or in the future exhibitions you can make use of more outdoor space? Second question is, Chairman, I've noticed that when it comes to the schedule of the Designation of Museums order, quite a number of museums include the name of the street, like we have the Museum of History and its address of number 58 on Haiphong Road. But in the latest amendment, it's only mentioned the museum name, but without the street name or street number. So how come there is such discrepancies in the list on the schedule? If we are to change the destination, then can we have a consistent presentation of information? Undersecretary, thank you, Mr. Chen, for your points. As for the War of Resistance exhibition, can we have an integrated display on that? We'll consider it. Actually, we have a display in the museum right now on the East River Column and the traces across new territories. We are using 3D model or approaches for people to access the information on them, but we'll consider how to expand the part, exhibition on the War of Resistance. And once this museum is set up, we'll consider how to provide more space. That, of course, also depends on our ability to get more resources. That means you have planned to expand the museum. We don't have a concrete plan, but that's our direction. We'll consider that. As for the amendment order, museum's amendment order, as mentioned by the chairman, we should be more precise in our information on the museums. We will do that. For example, we'll state very clearly exact location of the Hong Kong Museum of the War Resistance and Coastal Defense. We have a consistent approach and clear presentation of the address. Okay, it's not just, you need to have the street number, not just saying that it is located in Shao K1. Because for some museums, it has really precise address, where others, only the museum's names, it's only the name is mentioned. Yes, you need to have, we will have a consistent, unified way of presenting the address of various museums. Yes, we need to have a unified, precise presentation of the address. Okay, next one is Professor Lau Chipan. Thank you. For this topic, there are two key terms, which are more resistance and coastal defense. Looking at the geographical characteristics of Hong Kong, we are surrounded by the sea on three sides. So the wall of resistance is inseparable from the sea. So I think in terms of nature, it's compatible to have coastal defense put next to wall of resistance. Just now, listening to the administration's introduction, I want to add that Hong Kong, this place, in actual Chinese history, Tuen Mun was the place in Hong Kong that was mentioned first. And there were 2,000 soldiers stationed there. Well, compared to the more than 30,000 members of the Hong Kong police, we've got 2,000 soldiers stationed in Tuen Mun. Why? Because there was a necessity for a coastal defense facility to protect the maritime trade there. So therefore, coastal defense happened in Hong Kong long ago. Well, in the Ming Qing dynasties, there was a ban on maritime transportation back then because of the purpose of coastal defense. Not so much about war, but because of the presence of pirates in the sea. In Ming industry, Ming dynasty, of course, there were the overseas invaders as well. People thought that they were in the war code in Zhejiang, but in fact they had infiltrated the southern part of China. So another part of history related to coastal defense is in early Qing dynasty, the historical period then. It was due to a strategic plan for coastal defense in relation to Taiwan. The Lei Yu Mun Museum right now, of course, it was used during the British occupation period as a coastal facility. It's a good location. Geographically speaking, it met political, economic purposes. So because of it is in the right geographical location for those purposes. And in Guangdong, but I think we can extend the scope of the museum further to anti-Japanese war. Well, we can't just focus on 1941 to 1945, the occupation of the Hong Kong period, because our nation now, for the 8-year resistance against the Japanese invaders, according to history, it lasted a whole 13 years. We need to move backwards. The earliest date of Japanese invasion, it was in the Ming dynasty. And in recent history, it's also, of course, related to the Japanese invasion in the early 20th century. And also, before we had the occupation, we also had the naval fleet. actually of invading Hong Kong. So those historical events were closely related to Hong Kong and also this museum. So we should broaden the scope of the museum. I think we are very interested in listening to your points, but we can consider inviting him, Professor Lau, to come here periodically to give us more information. I just want to ask a question. That is, I support this museum, but in future days, would you find a better place to separate the exhibitions on resistance, war resistance, and coastal defense? Because there's so much to say about the war of resistance. Undersecretary, thank you, Professor Lau, for your valuable information, which have enriched our knowledge. I will consider that later on in our exhibits, we can broaden the scope so as to cover more of the history related to the topic. As Professor Lau said, there are a lot of other topics that could be showcased. So we'll consider in the long run whether we should set up two museums dedicated to the two themes. But in the short run, I think this is the appropriate arrangement for now. Vincent Chang, next. Thank you, Chairman. I was still listening to Professor. I want to keep listening to Professor Lau indeed about the history. My stance is that for the renaming of the Museum of Coastal Defense into the Hong Kong Museum of the War of Resistance and Coastal Defense, I support it. It's very meaningful, and it also sheds light on the war resistance history here. I've been to the museum many times since the museum was renovated. I find that the exhibits there have increased in variety and lots of information on the history and the work of the guerrillas were covered. After reopening, I think maybe not many people have been there again. So I've got some questions, particularly about the long-term development of the museum. Firstly, I hope that we can have more collaborations with mainland museums like those in Shenzhen, because the war of resistance that did not just affect Hong Kong. It happened in our neighboring cities as well, so I hope there can be more collaborations. And secondly, once the museum is open, well, I think that this museum, per se, is a bit hard to get to. You have to think of a way to find a way to get there. So in the future, would you think of ways to make it more attractive to visitors? The LCSD just staged the event of Bruce Lee Day. That's an attractive idea. So I think it's meaningful for you to attract the whole family with children to have a tour within the museum. And also for tourists, we kept talking about tourists, right? I also looked at the Tourism Commission's website. Well, there are a number of museums highlighted there on the Tourism Board's website. So can we enhance our publicity so as to attract more tourists to come to Hong Kong regarding visiting museum as part of their itineraries? And also, Shao Kei Wan, the name of the place, is a bit misleading. So I think we can talk more, tell the public more about that. This is a museum of the war dedicated to resistance and coastal defense.
Thank you, Chairman. Yes, we will work with more museums in China. That is our direction. We will work with the museum in Shenzhen to hold an exhibition, and we will work with even more museums in mainland China in the future regarding footfall. After the renovation, there are more than 270,000 visitors, including 500 school tours. We have invited dozens of principals to visit the museum, and we have also held guided tours for teachers. We want teachers to bring their students to the museum. We will continue to work on these public education efforts. Museums are destinations of in-depth travel, so we'll definitely enhance the publicity work on the tourism board. We'll standardize the amendment of the museums, and we will adopt a unified standard. Next, Mr. Ma Feng Kwok.
Thank you, Chairman.
We were still under British colonial rule when the Hong Kong MCD was set up. So it introduced the coastal defense history and facilities when we were under British colonial rule. After the public expressed their views, the Hong Kong MCD has been expanding its exhibits. There are a total of 11 galleries, four of which are on our history on the War of Resistance. Coastal defense is a narrow concept, whereas the War of Resistance is a much broader concept. The War of Resistance against Japanese aggression was a significant war. 35,000 soldiers sacrificed their lives in the war. If we need to change the name from Hong Kong MCD to Hong Kong Museum of the War Resistance and Coastal Defense, it seems, by the looks of it, these two words are equally important. But I do have a question. If we need to have a good record, historical record on the war resistance in relation to the protection of the place we lived in, its historical significance is way greater than coastal defense. When it comes to time, however, Hong Kong was a small fishing village. Coastal defense was meant to protect ourselves against pirates when we were under British colonial rule. We also needed to defend against, for example, Portugal, Spain, and so on. These were the possible enemies. But I don't think the concepts of war resistance and coastal defense should be lumped together. They need to be separate. For example, it's about the role the Chinese people played in the war of resistance against different enemies around the world. It didn't highlight the role of China in the war of resistance. So I think these contents should have been added to a museum of war resistance. We have limited space, so the contents are also limited. If we need to promote patriotism and national education, these are on the front burner. It's been 27 years since the handover. So how can we do this task well? War resistance and coastal defense are not at odds, but then we need to accord priority. It's very important to accord priority to war resistance and coastal defense. When we consider coastal defense alone in the budget debate, we have a warship that protected Hong Kong or the country for 24 years. It ceased service, so how can we better protect the warship? This is an important task of coastal defense. The warship has great meaning. Why didn't the Hong Kong MCD try to preserve this warship? Is it just because we have limited space, so we're not going to preserve it? That is the South Sea Fleet I'm talking about. Just now, Professor Lau also told us what he thinks about the link between war resistance and coastal defense. Different people have different views, but war resistance and coastal defense are all related to protecting our country, the place we live in. Since ancient times, it's been a theme that is applicable. War resistance, we can refer to the history back in Sino-Japanese War and the invasion from the Japanese. So it's actually difficult to draw a direct comparison. You can see that they are directly related, but you can also say that they are not directly related. As we have already mentioned, these two themes are rich in contents. In the long run, we can consider having two separate museums to showcase different exhibits of different themes, but it all depends on the availability of resources as well as the planning of museums. We're considering expanding the range of exhibits in the museums. But going back to the warship of the South Sea Fleet, can we actually keep the entire warship in the museum? That is a question. It's about the disposal of military equipment. We didn't think long and hard about this proposal, but now that a member gave us this suggestion, we can consider it. We can see whether this is feasible. Another warship also came to Hong Kong. It was from another area in China. Well, the warship from Liaoning, it's housed in another museum. So we can discuss with the China counterparts. Next, Ms. Elizabeth Quart. Thank you, Chairman. Well, Mr. Ma can probably let us know where the warship is right now. I'm interested to know. In the Hong Kong MCD, there were some negative experiences. It promoted the concept of Japan, and I made a complaint. We needed to have a museum of the war resistance, and we are now going to convert the Hong Kong MCD to the Hong Kong Museum of the War Resistance and Coastal Defense. Of course, I support this idea, but I hope that this is just a short-term proposal. The museum is a very small one, so we cannot show a lot of exhibits in the museum. To allow primary students to know the history of the War of Resistance and to cultivate a stronger sense of national esteem and patriotism, it's not sufficient. We need way more than that. So in the long run, we need to seek to build yet another museum. In another area, they had a separate museum on opium war. They talked about the repercussions of opium war, or opium per se. They show a lot of pictures, relics, exhibits in the museum. After visiting the museum, visitors know a lot about the impact of opium and opium war. Now that we also have the history on the East River Column, We are grateful to these martyrs. Some of them are still living in Hong Kong. So we can invite them for oral history or ask them to show some more relics. Making better use of technology does not mean scanning a QR code. As a matter of fact, we can reach out to martyrs whom we look up to, and we can prepare 3D videos featuring these martyrs so visitors will see them in the museum. These martyrs can tell visitors their emotions, their feelings firsthand, but owing to the small size of the museum, it's actually difficult to put in place these measures. The museum is very small right now, so we can make good use of virtual space to tell the public more about the history. So that the younger generation will be more interested in the history of the War of Resistance. I look forward to a separate museum of the War of Resistance. Undersecretary, thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Member. Member would like to have a separate museum featuring War of Resistance. We'll consider this proposal on leveraging on technology. Thank you, Ms. Elizabeth Quart, for your comment. We will consider your proposal. Our colleague will be in touch with you to see how we can better utilize technologies to enrich the contents of the museum. The Navy on the Chinese People's Liberation Army The Navy of the Hong Kong Independent Battalion of the East River Column and the Hong Kong Guerrilla have very rich content, so we can also incorporate all these contents into the museum. Mr. Ma mentioned warship. Even if we cannot accommodate the entire warship, we can still allow members of the public in Hong Kong to appreciate the history of the warship on virtual space. Mr. Ma can give us more information in the second round. Mr. Benson Look. Thank you, Chairman. Good morning, Undersecretary. To convert the Hong Kong MCD to Hong Kong Museum of the War Resistance and Coastal Defense, this is very good. The core of the War Resistance is to promote our patriotism. So when we can showcase patriotism through the name, it's actually very good. On the contents of the exhibitions, we need to show the coastal defense fortifications and elements in Guangdong and Hong Kong. We also need to show the historical facts of the invasion from the Japanese to Hong Kong or to China. This way we can enrich the contents of the museum regarding how we can really put this into practice. We can make good use of the boards and so on, but on enriching exhibits in the museums, it would be a good idea to have relics in the museums. This will show the history to visitors or even the younger generations. So I'd like to ask the administration whether you have any plan to seek help from the Central People's Government to show relics about the War of Resistance. We can house these relics in the Hong Kong Museum of the War Resistance and Coastal Defense. Apart from the Central People's Government, I believe there are also many collectors in the community. I'd like to know whether the administration has any plan to reach out to the collectors in the community. in the museums. I mean, there are also collectors telling us many government museums are not willing to have these collectors lend these relics or exhibits to museums. Instead, the administration want to buy these exhibits or relics once and for all. So I'd like to know if the administration has any plan or policy to collect relics and exhibits from collectors in the community. Just now, member also mentioned the geographical location of the Hong Kong Museum of the War Resistance and Coastal Defense. It was meant for coastal defense in ancient times, so it's not as convenient in terms of transport. The administration mentioned stepping up publicity. I'd like to know if there are any concrete policies. Thank you.
Mr. Lau, thank you, Chairman. First point about asking the central government to lend us more exhibits. As I said, we'll step up collaborations with mainland museums. So we will see whether we can borrow some exhibits from the mainland and make reference to as what Ms. Kwok said about the warships concerned. We can see whether we can stage 3D exhibitions using technology to show those exhibits to the public. As for collections from the general public, we will recruit exhibits from local collectors. The drive will begin in September. As for collectors, we have arrangements to borrow and also to solicit donations from collectors as well. So I think I can ask Assistant Director to supplement later on. And also, we just mentioned in March, we have arranged for school principals and teachers to tour around the site and also undertake some trainings to help them better arrange for their students to come to the museum. And we will also collaborate with tour guides to provide docent tours, training for them, so to facilitate them bringing more tourists to the site later on. So we'll consider all sorts of options. Assistant Director, as for soliciting donations of exhibits, in September, after the museum is renamed, we will begin the drive to solicit donations from collectors. We expect the whole drive to last for 1 year, and we also step up publicity to let the public know that we are calling for lendings or donations of exhibits. Having relics on display helps the public understand more about the history. So we do hope that the public, should they have any relics that can be donated to us, we very much hope that more will come forward. As for exhibits, the museum on a regular basis would negotiate with collectors for them to lend us or donate their collections to us for display. In terms of art pieces, since they have market value, we hope that, after the art pieces, they would be put on display first before being sold. But as for historic relics, there's no such requirement. Honestly, historic relics, compared to art pieces, do not have as high a market value. So for the Museum of Coastal Defense, we didn't ask for the collectors to sell the relics. Next one, Maggie Chen. Thank you, Chairman. I support the renaming of the museum into Hong Kong Museum of the War of Resistance and Coastal Defense. Also, like to ask the Undersecretary to adopt my opinion to update a list of the members of the East River Column and also to show off their certificates of honor. And also, in your answer to our questions just now and based on my past communication with the administration, the Undersecretary, Eva, and so forth, are actively looking into what can be done in response to our views. Early on, I thought maybe all it takes is a renaming, but now I find that I do have bigger confidence that with the joint efforts of members and the administration, a lot more can be done. Well, on the flag-raising ceremony, it is a good location for flag-raising. When I go to museums, I find that, well, normally there are lots of student visitors. So my suggestion is when the students come to this museum, you can invite them, involve them in the flag-raising ceremony so that they can have or develop deeper sense of patriotism. And also, barrier-free access. Well, for the gallery on the right-hand side, but there's a flight of stairs leading to the gallery. So I suggest that you should improve that and change it into a barrier-free entrance. And also, for the buildings at the museum, well, space is limited. But how can we expand the space area? Maybe you can look into opening up the hillside in Lei Yun Mun, where you can develop more resistance camps, or you can design various tourism trails or outdoor games, war games, or outdoor rescue efforts, simulations. Or you can also consider setting up war resistance cultural camp so as to highlight the also some activities related to the theme and also accommodate or to address the issue of limited space. Mr. Lau, thank you, Ms. Chen, for your viewpoints. Flag raising ceremony, we'll consider what can be done, but you need to have adequate training before we can have a solemn ceremony. So we may not be able to just have flag raising ceremony with any student who come into the museum. So there needs to be some kind of training. But there are lots of training in school already. Of course, I'm talking about trained students. Well, we think about that and see how we can arrange for that. For barrier-free access, we'll see how we can further make improvements in that regard. As for making good use of other spaces, like to set up outdoor war resistance camps or create better variety of outdoor activities for students. But we'll look into that and see what can be done. If there are any concrete proposals, we're willing to discuss them with you. Thank you, Chairman. Next one is Judy Chan. Thank you. First of all, well, I support the museum. For a long time, Hong Kong didn't have any museum that focuses on such an important part of history. Personally, my understanding of the anti-Japanese war all come from my grandparents. So now with this museum, we will help our next generations understand more about the past. I've got three proposals. First is I agree with our colleagues that we can, as mentioned, in terms of relics, we can try to call for donations of relics from collectors in the community. And if we so we can enrich the exhibitions at the museum. And how we can put on record, for example, not just the oral histories of members of the East River Column. I think there are lots of members of the public who are willing to, who like to listen to ordinary people, what they experienced during the Japanese occupation. Like my grandmother, for example, who's still alive, you know, they have their own memories of what they went through during the Japanese occupation period, what their lifestyles were like. I hope that the administration maybe can produce videos on ordinary people's experiences so that the future generations will know the, how fortunate they are compared to the past. And in terms of publicity, in many places now, people use a soft approach, that is to create spots where people can take pictures, good pictures, to attract visitors. Well, there are various platforms available, and in light of the good location of the museum, it has a cafe which overlooks the sea, has a full sea view. So this could become a place where tourists would like to come to take beautiful pictures. So that's what you can consider. And secondly, there are lots of parents at weekends who would try to look for all sorts of places to take their children to. So if you add to the museum some activities or elements which can entice students, children to stay for one whole day, then parents, then besides taking their kids there, parents can at the same time, while having fun, know more about the war resistance information. And thirdly, in Hong Kong, there are a lot of books on the East River Column. On the mainland, there are also lots of books about how they supported or provided support for the East River Column in Hong Kong. So I hope that in the future, the museum can set up a souvenir shop offering all kinds of materials and books related to the War of Resistance, so people can buy those publications easily at the site. Mr. Lau, thank you, Ms. Chen, for your viewpoints. They're all very good. Yeah, we can consider in our drive to appeal for donation of relics, we can ask for people who experienced difficult times during the occupation period to share with us their experiences and see whether we can create some oral histories, provide oral histories on that to enrich our exhibitions. And in terms of places for taking nice pictures, yes, I agree. We need to think of how to make good use of our museum to provide spots for picture taking. And Ms. Chen and Maggie Chen earlier also suggested that we can create more activities outdoor so that there can be more parent-child interactions, or for example, outdoor camps or activities related to the theme of the museum to attract more families to come and visit, of course, the museum. And this can indirectly promote patriotism. And thirdly, whether there should be a souvenir shop selling various books, well, it all depends whether you can find an appropriate space. But we can also arrange for, like, in September, in our library, we'll promote relevant books so we can step up publicity of the books which are available in the library for the public to borrow. Ms. Lee Wai King, Chairman, yes, as already mentioned by members, we all support the conversion of the museum so that the history on the War of Resistance can be highlighted. Particularly for the young generation, it's important to let them know more about the past. And in terms of the name, there are different views on it. So I hope that the administration can maybe seek advice from history experts and consider various views like those expressed by Mr. Ma. And thirdly, I've got some suggestions here. I'm very pleased to hear that you mentioned several times that you will, particularly with Shenzhen, you collaborate with them and there will be joint exhibitions held. You can borrow relics from museums over there. And on the whole topic of War of Resistance, you should not just focus on Hong Kong alone, but you can collaborate with Greater Bay Area or Shenzhen or other nearby cities to design actually an overall exhibition on the War of Resistance so as to help the young people have a more vivid understanding of the past. So I think the administration can consider moving in that direction. I also support what Judy Chen just said in promoting patriotism. Besides schools, we need to work with parents to encourage children, or children to encourage parents to engage in more parent-child activities. Visiting museums is a good entry point. So can the administration tell us, with the Greater Bay Area cities there, would you discuss with them offering museum pass that would take people to all museums in the area, not just in Hong Kong? You can actually offer museum pass covering all museums in the Greater Bay Area and Hong Kong, so parents can at all times take their students or children to visit those museums so that they can have a deeper understanding of the history, and children, yes, also would know more about the relevant history. And thirdly, the contributions of the East River Column. We do, of course, respect the column, and there are lots of historical sites related to them that have not been given much attention. What's your plan on that?
Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Ms. Dari Li, for your views and suggestions. We'll follow up on your suggestion on the museum pass with the GBA cities. We'll consider it. We can work with these museums to see whether our priorities align with one another, and we'll actively consider your proposal. On the suggestion of museum pass, we will also work on this idea, but actually many museums in Hong Kong are free admission, so we don't have to really promote the idea of museum pass. Like other countries, they encourage members of the public to visit museums, so museums are free of charge. So what about West Kowloon Cultural District? Well, they have their own special features, so the concerns are different. Regarding the East River Column, we'll think how to better present the award certificates and so on. Regarding the preservation of wartime sites, we'll consider how to better protect these sites. But as I said, it's all about the deployment of resources and priority. We'll put in place these measures step by step. Ms. Dari Li mentioned booking guided tours. These are valuable resources. Right, we accept advance bookings from schools as well. We can also work with different museums in the Guangdong province to see how we can work with one another. Say when our schools go to Guangdong, we can make advance bookings and vice versa. Mr. Lam Chun Sing. Thank you, Chairman. I support the amendment order as well. Over the Easter holidays, I went north and I went to the museum and went to the Sea View Cafe on the second floor. I read information, I visited the museum, and it was a pleasant experience. I hope that the museum can play a bigger role in patriotic education. There's an association under the FTU, the former Royal Navy, I mean the Chinese who served in the Royal Navy or logistics work. They are in this association, but of course, after the handover, they could not work in the Navy, and they joined the society, they join the workforce once again. Some members join in the war of resistance against Japanese aggression. Some also applied for a funding from the government, from the Labour and Welfare Bureau. Hong Kong has a very special historical context. These members who used to serve the Royal Navy have made contributions to the coastal defense in Hong Kong. So I hope that they will also be featured in the museum. I mean, they have applied for the Hong Kong War Memorial Pensions from the LWB. This amendment order will take place on the 3rd of September. In 2015, it was the 70th anniversary of the War of Resistance. So we have a statutory holiday to commemorate the Victory Day of Chinese People's War of Resistance against Chinese aggression. Next year is going to be the 80th anniversary. So will the administration have a statutory holiday on the 3rd of September in 2025 to commemorate the 80th anniversary of the Victory Day of Chinese People's War of Resistance against Japanese aggression? This will be a good example of patriotic education, and members of the public will appreciate the peaceful state even better. It's not a focal point of the amendment, but it is a suggestion that I would like to float to the administration. Next year is going to be the 80th anniversary on the Victory Day. So does the museum have any plan to promote the Victory Day of Chinese People's War of Resistance against Japanese aggression? First of all, regarding the contributions of Chinese soldiers in Royal Navy, in Eastern Asia, many countries were at war with Japan. So we can also mention some history events, historical events to the visitors. Regarding the idea about the 3rd of September in 2025, we will consider this proposal. That is whether we are going to have a statutory holiday on the 3rd of September 2025. We will think long and hard about it. Thank you, member. It's the 80th anniversary next year. Will there be large-scale publicity by the museum? Yes, definitely. We do want to explain the history of war resistance to the public. That's the very purpose of the museum. We'd also like to foster patriotic education. So we'll definitely have large-scale publicity next year. This year marks the founding, marks the 75th anniversary of the founding of the country. So probably we can combine these two elements together. Next, Mr. Kenneth Falk. Thank you, Chairman. To convert the Hong Kong MCD to the Hong Kong Museum of War Resistance and Coastal Defense, I support it. It plays a significant role in patriotic education. I go along with many members. I hope that this will be a short-term abandoned solution only, because in the long run, we need to have other policies, and I'm not going to repeat the points. I hope the administration will find a place to showcase the significance of the war resistance. The administration mentioned different concerns such as the priority of resources, deployment of resources, and so on. But I'm thinking whether we can do more with existing resources. Of course, from the perspective of the CSTB, they need to better maintain the museums. But it's about the spirit of war resistance and coastal defense. There are many resources in Guangdong province. In the papers, it mentioned collaboration with Shenzhen as well as Guangdong provinces, such as Hunan and Nansha. So are there any collaboration opportunities with these areas in Guangdong? There are many forts in Guangdong. We have different forts in the Guangdong area. There are also different museums such as Chumun Museums, Opium War Museums, East River Column Museums, and so on. So can we take this as a starting point to discuss collaboration with these museums? When we promote this concept, the responsibility does not only lie in the CSTB, but the HYAB and the Education Bureau also should chip in. We have a lot of existing resources. The HYAB has a committee on youth, and they have the relevant subcommittees. So I believe they can help as well. You also have a subcommittee on civic education. So can we consolidate these resources, pull these resources, so that we can partner with other museums to accomplish this task? Some 15 years ago, Dr. Deng went with me to Hormun Fort, and I listened to Dr. Deng. I learned more about many historical events. I didn't find it boring at all. So can the administration explore this proposal? Can you redeploy existing resources to enhance the existing work? Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Kenneth Falk. We'll try to discuss with the partners, I mean different museum partners in the Guangdong province, to see how we can achieve synergy and make good use of their resources at the same time. Whether on the concept of war resistance or coastal defense, they are inextricably linked to the protection of country and patriotic education. So I agree that different bureaus should work hand in hand. In the government, we also have a working group on patriotic education. We are exploring different means to promote patriotic education. We'll relay members' view to the relevant subcommittee or task force to see how we can use our existing resources to accomplish this task. Next, myself, I support the amendment order. There's much information in the papers. Mr. John Lee, the chief executive, also mentioned, apart from the Hong Kong Museum of the War Resistance and Coastal Defense, we also have, from the chief executive, and other new museum, that is a museum on the development and achievements of our country. In the document, the wording can be made even more accurate. For example, in paragraph 8, we, after the handover, the expression, the text could have been written in a more accurate manner. In the document, it says that the museum aims at cultivating a stronger sense of national esteem and patriotism among the public. We already have a Grade 3 memorial museum. There's also a cenotaph listed on the agenda of the government. We can combine all these resources as the theme is war resistance. Professor Lau mentioned different historical events, and they may be as long as 100 years or so. So we have a lot of existing resources. We don't have to use additional resources to do this well. We can partner with different military facilities and different partners in the mainland. There are four main galleries that is the narrative of the war of resistance, joint hands to resist Japanese invasion of Hong Kong, anti-Japanese guerrillas behind enemy lines. We can tell the public more about our fruits and results. That is because we had a very strong coastal defense team. So events such as forcible occupation in the 1840 will not happen again. The museum may be more remote, but we can have cold surfaces such as red tourism. They can divert visitors. When many red tourism visitors come to Hong Kong, they don't go to cramped areas in Hong Kong. So 100 million visitors go to red tourism areas. So we can enrich the content when the museum is under the purview of the CSTB. Television channels in the mainland also work on oral history. It is recognized by the country. We can introduce oral history to Hong Kong. So can we introduce more resources about war resistance to Hong Kong? So these are my suggestions. I'd like to see if the administration has any reply. Thank you.
Yes, in terms of wordings, we'll be more careful with them later on to use precise language. Thank you, Chairman, and Mr. Yu's suggestion. As for integrating relevant resources, yeah, we'll consider how we can do a better job on that. You mentioned all those locations. We'll see how we can integrate the offerings there. And collaboration with the PLA based here, we'll see what can be done. Chairman, you're right. Our coastal defense facilities, Navy facilities are very advanced. So some of the visitors may be very keen to know more about various navies and warships. So we can perhaps come up with themes on coastal defense, various aspects of it. So we'll see what can we do more in the future. In terms of outreach, yes, we'll do that and to see how we can promote the museum more and bring in additional resources. Some groups may have resources that we can share with them or bring into the museum to better promote the Museum of the War of Resistance and Coastal Defense and its exhibitions. Okay, Ma Fong Kwok is an expert in military affairs, so you may consult him more. Okay, now it's the second round for Q&A. You may press the button if you have questions. Mr. Ma Fong Kwok. Thank you, Chairman. Just now, questions asked about the ship. Well, it's called Nanhai warship. It is a missile warship. When it was in service, it was number 279 with a weight of 50 tons. Now it's stationed in Fouyang City, Anhui Province. It is based at a museum in Kaohsiung City. Of course, this warship, if it can be kept, of course, it'll be good. You may want to also showcase some of the facilities or parts on board the warship. If the warship itself cannot be transported here, because it is actually a military development. So you can discuss with mainland authorities and talking about coastal defense. You should discuss with the Navy of the PLA based in Hong Kong and see if they have any actual exhibits that we can borrow. I think nobody ever discussed with them. So I think that's something that's not so satisfactory. And also, Just now, I forgot to mention, when it comes to war of resistance and coastal defense, they seem to be related, but at different levels. War of resistance is on a higher level. In Guangzhou, I saw that three museums were integrated into one, including the Intangible Cultural Heritage Museum and also the other museum on art pieces. And we saw the opening of our literature museum 2 weeks ago here. And I was saying that, well, in Guangdong, they have 5,000 square meters of exhibition space. But in Hong Kong, the Hong Kong Museum is only about 300 square meters in space. So that's the actual constraint we have here. So our exhibits actually are very limited compared to the ones in the mainland museums. Naming, on the other hand, is important because it causes people to think, to wonder. So it's fine to put this museum of war, of resistance and coastal defense under one roof, but there are indeed two separate parts there. So in terms of naming and the exhibits, we need to see whether there's any room for us to separate the two, or do you think that we need to change, further amend the museum's order, or do you think this existing order is already adequate to fit the purpose? So my other point is in terms of our perspective on history. In dealing with such historical facilities, a way of describing the past relates to our perspective on history. So we need to have a proper perspective. When it comes to war resistance, in Hong Kong, in our fight against invasions, not just about Japanese, but in what happened in 1899 when the British soldiers implemented three treaties and to have the territory ceded, it faced strong resistance from the real residents in the new territories. And it happened, there's a 6-day war that happened, which resulted in the loss of 500 lives in the real areas. Well, in the end, the villagers had no choice but to sign a treaty or a petition asking for the British soldiers to come to rule over them. And then the British chief secretary here was responsible for the document. So strictly speaking, it was Hong Kong people fighting against foreigners, a brave act of locals. But for that particular part of history, there is little mention of it. So of course, well, we have the war of resistance covering, of course, the war against the Japanese, which incurred led to the deaths of 35 million people. But we also have this other element of history where people sacrificed their lives as well in the fight. So should we include that? Should we highlight that particular element of history in the museum as well? Mr. Lau? Yes, I would ask the assistant director to talk about the 6-day war. Well, actually, we did mention that in the Museum of Coastal Defense, and particularly in collaborating with Guangdong on the Nanhai warship, whether we can collaborate with them to showcase some models or parts of the warship or have some 3D scanning of the parts. I think that's what we're considering, to let the public in Hong Kong can see the Nanhai warship. Discussions with the PLA stationed in Hong Kong, whether we can showcase any of the facilities, we'll follow up on that. As for the naming, I understand that there are people who actually would look at history in a more sentimental way. But in Hong Kong, where every inch of territory is sacred, And now, since the museum itself can date back to the Ming Qing dynasty in terms of coastal defense, and to have the museum at the location, I think we have chosen the right location. And like BLA in Hong Kong also used a lot of British facilities inherited from the colonial period. So whether we should have two separate museums in the future, well, we can consider that, as I said. There are lots of topics that can be covered by the museum. For example, submarines or other coastal facilities, or to broaden the scope of war resistance. There's a lot of materials that can be covered, I agree. As Professor Lau says, that can date back to the anti-Japanese war. So I agree, all those topics offer rich, and in the long run, we can consider whether we should create more museums to cover all those rich elements. Professor Lau Chi-Pen? Yeah, I just want to supplement on the Six-Day War. 2 years ago, after the Museum of Coastal Defense was reopened, we actually increased the content of exhibition on unequal treaties. In that particular gallery on unequal treaties, we have covered the Six-Day War. And also, as mentioned by the chairman, we are honored to have the invitation of the CCTV in Beijing. And last Saturday, we have a 90-minute episode dedicated to national treasures, which include the exhibits or collections in the HKMCD. And one of the exhibits, or some of the exhibits, are related to the Six-Day War in Hong Kong. And we stress that when the new territories were ceded, there was this Six-Day War. Professor Lau? Thank you, Chairman. Having heard from members and the administration, I found that the entire museum really fits the context of Hong Kong. We are now dealing with, for example, issues like subdivided flats. So it's like we are also subdivided flat tenants, so we have to share limited space. I think we can move to a bigger area later on and climb up the ladder further on, have our own property eventually, but that's off the topic. I think it also is about how we view the whole thing before we can decide what should the museum be called. I wasn't finished just now. I think it's worth us expand the scope. In Hong Kong, historically, events that happened that are related to coastal conflicts or war of resistance affects the whole world, even China. Like what happened in the Ming Dynasty, a coastal war, because which marked the first time China actually in Tumun in 1521, when China engaged in conflict with foreigners for the first time in history. It was really not the war with Dutch in Taiwan, over Taiwan. So that major conflict happened in Hong Kong, and we won the war back in those days. And then we can attract people from Macau to come to see the museum as well. And also the Opium War also took place here. We won 2-0 first, but in the second half of the war, we lost. So different wars happened in Hong Kong, and that should be mentioned. Otherwise, you cannot bring out the relationship between resistance war and coastal defense. I think for the museum, we need to sort out the facts. That's the historical perspective, like during the war, British soldiers engaged in a war to protect Hong Kong, and we have the East River Column and other guerrillas resisting during the occupation period of 3 years and 8 months. And in Huizhou, there were military collaborations. So we should provide more information on that. And now the positioning of the museum, of this museum, is affected by the historical perspective laid down during the colonial period. So people think that it's only, that there were the 18 days when the British soldiers protected Hong Kong from foreign invasion. But that's more. There's more than that. We strove hard to restore other elements of the history. But people would just mix everything together. Mixing British soldiers with the local guerrillas. The 18-day war fought by the British soldiers, the lives lost were actually fighting, were being loyal to the British government. But in the local guerrillas and the including the East River Column, those warriors were fighting to protect the sovereign territory of the whole nation. So you can't mix those wars together. So you need to explain the information within the museum. That's important history. Therefore, I hope that the administration can consider, particularly for this museum, there should be a steering committee formed to set up to look at the content of the exhibition and see what information should be presented. Otherwise, people will just mix all the facts together. The protection by the British soldiers are just one part of history for the glory of the British Empire. But there were the East River Column and the Hong Kong Kowloon guerrillas fighting for the territory of the nation.
Mr. Raisin Lau. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Professor Lau, for the comments and views. We will start with the perspective of Hong Kong and country in the setup of the Hong Kong Museum of the War Resistance and Coastal Defense. We will also hear from the community regarding suggestions on having steering committees. We'll consider this proposal as well. Thank you, Chairman. Well, actually, all members have been giving you their views like a consultative task force. Mr. Tang Fei, the first round, so we're going to let Mr. Tang speak first. Thank you, Chairman. In the short run, I agree with the change in the name of the museum from the Hong Kong MCD to the Hong Kong Museum of the War Resistance and Coastal Defense. I've been to the Hong Kong MCD for many times. As I said to members, it focused on the period under the British colonial rule. Hong Kong already existed before 1842. We didn't exist just after 1842. Like in Tang Dynasty, we already existed. It may be difficult for us to look for historical events, history, a long time ago, but it's not impossible. Just like Song Wong Toi, we already successfully found some relics, so it's really not impossible. When it comes to war resistance, it's not just about war resisting at sea, it's also about war resistance on land. Whether it's the 18th day of the British Armed Forces or the Hong Kong Independent Battalion of the East River Column, they also took place on land. So war resistance and coastal defense are not directly related. We should have a separate museum on war resistance. The Hong Kong Museum of Coastal Defense should not start with, I mean, should not start from the year 1842. It should also cover the period before that.
We mentioned many times Gorilla on the East River Column. Apart from Gorilla, the East River Column also made great contributions. The Intelligence Department relied heavily on the East River Column. So when we collected the history about the East River Column, apart from the Gorilla, the East River Column and its alliance, like the forces of the China, they collected a lot of intelligence. They did a lot on intelligence collection. When we mentioned the East River Column, we didn't touch upon it frequently, but it was frequently mentioned in mainland media, so we can add these points to the history. So we need to have a separate museum for war resistance, and the Museum of Coastal Defense should not be limited to the period after the year 1842. It should also cover the period before that. Mr. Raisin Lau, thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Member. We want to cover all aspects as much as possible, from the ancient times, the imperial period, to the future. We do want to cover all these aspects as well. We can discuss with the relevant Chinese counterparts to see how they can enrich the contents of our exhibits or collection. Regarding war resistance, yes, I do agree with members. We can strengthen the aspect of intelligence collection by the East River Column. We do have these aspects. I can invite Mr. Ng to give you more information. Just now, Professor Lau mentioned the opening of Hong Kong in Tang Dynasty to the soldiers being stationed in Tuen Mun. We also cover this period in the museum. We can look for more historical events, but owing to the limited space, we may not be able to house many exhibits. However, we do have a room for these historical events, including the Battle of Tuen Mun, as mentioned by Professor Lau. We will house these exhibits or historical events in the gallery. We will also be displaying images about the historical events and the intelligence collection work in partnership with the British Armed Forces. We will step up our work in this regard. One supplementary question from me. We are not just going to change the name of the museum, but it's all about the theme, significance, and the status. It's about the improvement, or I mean enhancement, of national esteem and patriotism. Do you have any KPI before the changing of the name, the visiting arrangements, and so on, after the enriched contents of the museum? Do we have more schools, more visitors? We need a survey. We need these statistics. So even if it is not convenient, we do need to see how we can further expand the museum. We can also enrich the contents of the museum. So the Museum on the Development and Achievements of Our Country can draw reference from the Hong Kong Museum of the War Resistance and Coastal Defense. The Army of the, the PLA on important days. They do have a very comprehensive gallery. While we cannot copy 100% from the museum or gallery, we can also purchase some exhibits or collectibles and place them in the museum in Hong Kong. They have open days, and we do make applications to bring tours to these museums.
there are many ways to expand the scope or coverage of a museum. We can make good use of the existing resources. I agree. So I'll see how we can conduct surveys, how to set KPIs, to see which areas actually interest visitors so that we can enrich the relevant areas. We will also be in touch with the PLA more often to see what kind of resources they can provide in order to enrich the contents of our exhibitions or galleries. Also, we can work with them to hold, for example, parent camps or parent-children camps. If there are more contents about the PLA, probably they can appeal to an even wider audience. In the second round, two more members, Ms. Maggie Chen and Mr. Chen Siu Hong, and Mr. Ma Feng Kwok in the third round. I will draw a line right here if no other members would like to speak. Ms. Maggie Chen, please. Thank you, Chairman. Just now, Professor Lau told us about the situation, and I agree with Professor Lau. Professor Lau is an expert in history, and I'd like to take the perspective of a visitor of the museum. The overall layout of the museum after visiting museum well, I should put it this way. After students visit the museum, they will find that a lot of countries, a lot of different armies were at war in Hong Kong. But then the museum is aimed at showing how the people in Hong Kong to protect our homes and defend our country. This is the aim of the museum. Just now, the administration said that they would enrich the contents of the Hong Kong Independent Battalion of the East River Column. The exhibits seem to be quite scattered throughout the museum. There's no perspective of professionalism. So in the course of enhancement, we do need to enrich the contents of the Hong Kong Independent Battalion of the East River Column. It really shows how the people of Hong Kong protected our homes and defended our country. And I must emphasize, it's the Hong Kong Independent Battalion. We have a thematic exhibition or gallery about the Hong Kong Independent Battalion, and we will enhance the layout, and we will also enrich the contents of this gallery. We'll start from the perspective of the nation to showcase different exhibits. Just now, Professor Lau gave us very useful views, such as how to tap the pulse of the community so that we can start from the perspective of the community and nation. We'll continue with our dialogue with the community. Next, Mr. Chen Siu Hong. Thank you, Chairman. The Hong Kong Museum of Coastal Defense is going to be converted and renamed into the Hong Kong Museum of the War Resistance and Coastal Defense. I'd like to give you my views. The name is changed. But regarding the contents, I don't want the contents of war resistance to be limited owing to space constraints. I don't want an imbalanced focus on war resistance and coastal defense. For example, when we give more focus on war resistance, there will be less focus on coastal defense. This proposal seems to us that it is just a band-aid solution. When we want to focus more on war resistance, we occupy the space of Coastal Defense in the Hong Kong Museum of Coastal Defense. The Undersecretary mentioned that they would look for even more space, but I do think that the administration should roll out a grand scheme on the layout of museums in Hong Kong. There are a total of 40 museums in Hong Kong. We have the Northern Metropolis. We also have reclamation of more areas in Hong Kong. So can we start from the top to plan from the top? We need to promote national esteem and patriotism. So what can we do? We will have more space, such as the Central Waters, the Northern Metropolis, and so on. Just now, Professor Lau shared his expertise with us. If we have rich contents in war resistance, it may be worthwhile to have a separate museum of the war resistance, and that would entail midterm and long-term planning. Regarding the history of protecting homes and defending country, the people of Hong Kong protected homes and defended the country, and we need to separate these and another historical event. We shouldn't lump them together. We need to have a steering committee with experts on the board, for example, Professor Lau can serve as a chairperson of the steering committee. We have a Hong Kong Museum of History in Hong Kong. So whenever any history, any historical events involve war resistance, we need to set the record straight as well. So if the, if Professor Lau is appointed as the chairman, we shouldn't limit the museum to simply the Museum of the War Resistance. There should be a consultative board of museums. The consultation committee on museums should be wider in scope. We need to set the record straight from the historical perspective. We need to have an official version of historical events. So the new committee can do the work on this front. Thank you.
That's the view expressed, Secretary. Thank you, Chairman. Yes, I agree with Mr. Chen. In the medium long-term planning, yes, we would actually, go back to the panel to tell them our strategy for future developments of the museum, for example, the future layout of the museum and so forth. And just then, Professor Lau and Mr. Chen talk about setting up a dedicated committee to help us set the record straight. We'll consider that and see what we can do structure-wise. And on war resistance and coastal defense, the relationship, we have had a good, rich discussion today. In fact, we can look at a long, long history of coastal defense, and the war resistance covers more than the anti-Japanese war. It also can include Hong Kong's history of fighting against foreign invasion. So the periods of history to be covered could be long and the content very rich. And also, as Professor Lau said, all these are intertwined. Hong Kong is a coastal city after all. Our fight against the war, our protection efforts are inseparable from land and sea. Since we are a coastal city, it's much easier for invaders to attack from the sea. So people can come from everywhere. So coastal defense remains an important part of the content. So for the long run, we can think of whether there should be more space provided or other museum sites to cover all the rich topics. We'll give more thoughts to that. Okay, lastly, two more members will ask questions, and then we'll begin the clause-by-clause scrutiny. Ma Feng Kwok? Thank you, Chairman. In my second round, I suggested the name that whether we can make reference to what I just saw in Guangzhou, the integration of three museums, and name them all by the phrase cultural center. The government hasn't responded yet. Do you think that is possible in Hong Kong? Or under a main museum, there can be a sub-museum, and with the war resistance being the theme of the main museum, and coastal defense as the theme of the sub-museum. And a part of Hong Kong history that has been neglected is that during the Japanese occupation period, the Japanese soldiers put 100,000 Hong Kong people, moved them to Guangzhou, a refugee camp there, and they carry out live experiments there among the 100,000 people moved to Guangzhou. This history was little known, but in recent years it has been made known to more people. And since we have this 100,000 lives sacrificed, they're all Hong Kong people, and that's an important part of our history. I wonder in the days ahead whether the Hong Kong Museum of the War of Resistance can highlight that history as well, because that's an important element. And also, my other point is about the naming. Or you can have two names for the museums, two museum names, or one main museum and one sub-museum. Or is there any room for any amendment to change the museum order? Yes, we did consider about the naming, and we have had some discussions on that already, and we explained actually war resistance and coastal defense, we think that they are related. And we put war resistance first in the name because war resistance should come first, we think. And that highlight the war resistance part more. And I think that with the name now is appropriate, and most members support it. So I think we would keep it for now. Going forward, we will consider maybe we need two separate museums, we'll see. Within the museum, we can have clearer demonstration, presentation of the information on war resistance, separate from that on coastal defense. And also, on Nam Shat Tau, I'll ask the director to supplement. Yeah, the element of history related to Nam Shat Tau is quite complicated. But in our Hong Kong story permanent exhibition at the Hong Kong History Museum, we will cover that event. So you would have that event covered in the other museum, yes. How about high-level museums, like the Museum of Development, showcasing the development of achievements of our country? I think we need to collect more public opinions on that, on how we should set up that museum as well. Yes. Next one, Tang Fei. Thank you, Chairman. I appreciate what the Undersecretary just said, that we need to link up the history of the Greater China. So whether it is war resistance or coastal defense, we need to break through the break away from the limits of time and geographical location. People tended to focus on the period of 3 years and 8 months of occupation period. But indeed, the anti-Japanese efforts began much longer before that. And even during the back in 1931, the 918 event happened, and that already triggered much war resistance efforts. So we should not just focus in our museum on the Japanese occupation period in Hong Kong that lasted more than 3 years, like some overseas Chinese in Southeast Asia. Also, they talk about the contributions of our country. Even the East River Column they didn't only just move around in Hong Kong and Shenzhen. They actually fought all the way to Shandong. So we need to provide some supplementary information to correct some misconceptions, because we need to let the public, particularly secondary primary school students, know more. Now, in schools, students need to learn about Chinese history, but Chinese history teachers, well, they may not have studied much Chinese history in school, when they were in school. So the these museums are a good source of learning for students and to correct people's understanding of the history of China. Secretary, thank you, Mr. Tang, for your opinions. As you said, we do want to broaden the scope of the theme. And we don't just focus on the anti-Japanese war, which of course lasted more than 3 months, which is not just the 3 months period. It lasted, the anti-Japanese efforts lasted 13 years indeed. So our theme is on war of resistance, overall war of resistance, including the anti-Japanese war as well as other invasions by foreigners. Dating back, as Professor Lau, such resistance wars could go back all the way to the Ming dynasties. So we will cover that. As for the East River Column, of course, they operated in vast areas, but we focus on the efforts in Hong Kong. But later on, we can see how we can broaden the scope of exhibition on the East River Column, covering what they did even beyond Hong Kong. As I said, we will step up collaborations with mainland museums. We can share resources. And as mentioned just now, as Mr. Fox said, we can create platforms together to guide visitors to different museums and to see different exhibits and have various experiences so that, well, they can have access to different exhibits and historical relics. Yeah, the content of history is definitely rich. After renaming, as the chief executive and secretary mentioned, we will focus on the history of war resistance and enhance the public's cultural confidence and patriotism. On the Designation of Museums order, I think we finished the Q&A. Now we can begin the clause-by-clause scrutiny. You may make reference to CB bracket 2785/2024/01 paper. So may I ask the secretary to take us through the text, and then we can express our views on it. I'll ask the director. Yes, we are proposing the amendment of the chapter 132 subsidiary legislation P, the schedule, to cancel point 13. Yes, another is what mentioned by members about the standardization of address in the schedule, so that we can make the addresses clearer and conform to unified standards. Any points, viewpoints, opinions on the schedule? Chen Xiuhong.
Okay, 好簡單啫.
Thank you, Chairman. So just now, Chairman, you also reminded us, while I was speaking, I mentioned the issue with the address. I hope the administration is not going to amend the address 1 or 2 years later. If there's a need to amend the address, I hope the administration will do it as soon as possible. We need to have a standard. The Hong Kong Museum of War Resistance and Coastal Defense has its original address. For other museums, We have, for example, 41 Tonkin Street, Sham Shui Po. Say, for Shao Kei Wan, Tai Han, if there's more than one name, I mean more than one address, we need to state the street name as well. I believe members of the public would need to have a set of criteria. We need a standard. That's all I want to say. And I hope the administration will do it as soon as possible, instead of coming back and make the amendments 8 years later, 10 years later, or so on. If members do not object, I will extend the meeting by 10 minutes. Undersecretary, yes, for amendment orders in the future, we will adopt the same standard. If there is more than one museum in an area, we will state more details about the address, for example, the street name, the number of the street, and so on. The purpose is to avoid confusion or misunderstanding. Mr. Ma Fung Kwok, there's no clear reference to the address of the museum, but actually the museum occupies a large area. There are many hillsides in the museum. Is it possible that without amending the legislation, we can also expand the area? Isn't that the case, Undersecretary? Well, we're simply changing the name of the museum. The definition will not be changed. Within the area of the museum, the government can add or construct any additional ancillary facilities. Now, I'd like to ask the legal advisor to confirm the English text of the amendment order. Is that free of error? No issues? Yes, indeed. Thank you, legal advisor. So the Undersecretary and the Director, if you would like to give us more information or supplementary information based on members' views, you can submit written submissions to us. And you can also give us timely updates. The meeting today is a good history lesson. All members actively took part in the discussion today. LegCo members will also have more information in this connection. We have had a fruitful discussion today, so let's see what members think. We may not need to have a public hearing in the future, or invite written submissions from the public to express their views on the amendment order. Is that right? If so, we do not need to hold a public hearing, nor do we need to invite written submissions from the public. Regarding the legislative timetable, I'd like to let members know, according to the conventional practice, before the deadline for giving notice on amendments, we will report to the House Committee. The scrutiny period is going to expire on the 19th of June 2024. If members have no objections or other views, I will move the motion on the 19th of June 2024. And I will also extend the scrutiny period to the 10th of July 2024. That's also a couple of days later than the handover anniversary of Hong Kong. The deadline for giving notice for amendments regarding the amendment order is the 3rd of July 2024, and I'm going to report to the House Committee on the 28th of June 2024. Any more business? If there's no any other business, we don't need to have another meeting. No AOB? Thank you. Meeting adjourned.